Everyone, welcome to another session of BNK's ideation series. I am Sanjeev Mota from BNK. I have with me some very special guests. We have Mr. PVR Raja, Chairman and Managing Director of Ramco Cement, and Mr. AV Dharmakrishna, Chief Executive Officer. Thank you, gentlemen, for participating in this and spending your valuable time, and welcome to this fireside chat. We also have Amit Srivastava, who heads our building material and cement sector. So as we said, we'll talk about the structural issues, some of the organizational issues, past and some future. As we said, you know, we're going to only talk about what is published, so, you know, but just some color on those. I'll start with asking some questions and then Amit will take over. And anyone has any questions, please put it on the Q&A box so we will ask the question. So, sir, maybe we can start. Mr. Raja, we can start with you if that is okay. And, you know, just wanted to understand what is the philosophy of managing this business in terms of you as a promoter? How do you look at managing this business? Plus, you know, in fact, even the next generation, how is Abhinav and you involved in this business? What's your role?
I think we are fully involved in the business. But given that, you know, we have a strong leadership and Mr. Dharmakrishna, all those things, I think we defer most of the operations issues and everything to Dharmakrishna, and that is what takes most of the time. I think our responsibility is to work with Dharmakrishna and his team to make sure how we build for the future and where do we go from here. And that consumes a lot of time because, you know, quite a lot of dynamics in the cement industry. So I think we spend a lot of time on that.
Right.
And as you know, we are always committed to creating very solid institution which can continue to grow.
And sir, what are the challenges that is facing?
I'll add a little bit.
Yeah.
See, right from beginning, it is not an individual company.
Right.
You see, last 60, 70 years, it is a group of companies. It's a group of companies. It's not the question of a single company. Right? See, 1933, the group was started with spinning mill. Then 1958, the cement was incorporated, cement company was incorporated. 1960, even the family is involved in multiple businesses, even the RCL is 1960. Then in 65, 66, we started roofing seat business. Then in 80s, we started Ramco Systems. See, like that, the group is involved in different verticals. This is not new. We are, for last 56 years, we are managing that. So the promoters spent, They are hands-on on the business. They spend all the capital expenditures, everything thoroughly discussed with the promoters and all these things. Mostly the operating part, normally the CEOs, not the question of today, it's not starting with me. We see even the textile group, one Mr. Rajagopal was CEO of textile mill almost for 30 years. Like that, the one biggest advantage with our group, senior management stays with the group for a very, very long time.
Yes.
See, like me, I am putting almost 40 years surveys. If you see the different companies, senior management, not really, I'm not only CEO, even the technical people, finance people, see, everybody stays with the company for a very, very long time. Okay, to that extent, there is a cordial relationship between promoters as well as the professionals. And whatever business we are in, if you see, we are benchmark, maybe textiles. The last 40, 50 years, if you ask, okay, the entire company, even though you are only spinning, okay, even the price of yarn in the entire country was benchmarked against our mill.
Right.
Okay, to that extent, we create brand for our products, we create qualities benchmark, the price is always, we don't sell at premium, we don't compromise our premium, certain. And we also very friendly in the sense we take every stakeholders together. It may be supplier, it may be our contractors, it may be our buyers, maybe our employees. We never treat them differently. Okay, we take every one of them as our stakeholders. See, there is one of the greatest asset of Ramco Group. Unlike certain companies feel, the creditors are the bankers, the suppliers are the bankers. Okay, they will be tough in negotiating with them. I'll pay after 3 months, or after 5 months, after 6 months. Okay, to that extent, the suppliers are the bankers. We never take suppliers or banker, we take them as our partner, so that I'm prepared to pay advance payment if necessary, if they are in trouble, or reasonable credit, or none of my suppliers are more than 10 to 15 days credit. Maximum a week. For example, ours in cement industry, ours is the only company, many companies says, okay, I pay to the transporters after 1 month, I'm able to take credit terms. I can proudly say I will pay next day. Automatically, this account will be credited next day. Even if you don't submit the bill. Okay, to that extent, okay, when we go such level, then you can expect the amount of cooperation from them also.
Yes.
See, there are, I know, certain vendors, they have shut down the shop in the last 9 months or 1 year, certain known vendors, because some of my competitors, they didn't pay to you. Okay, to that extent, we are the most preferred supplier, most preferred vendor to him. And he could say, okay, my first, even I want certain help from them, they were out of way to help. For example, my transporters are such a, this one, we always fund them. Even I don't tell them, go to bank, I'm ready to fund you. Whatever your margin money, all these things, I'm ready to fund you. Okay, we pay advance payment, next day payments, all these things. When even during the lockdown last year, when they partially lifted, just I'm telling you, even when they partially lifted the lockdown, we are the first company in India to move cement and to full capacity. Okay, to that extent, they cooperate. Even certain drivers took beating from the police people because certain areas might have been under lockdown, all these things. They're ready to risk their life, they're ready to take beating from the police, but they think, okay, I have service to this company. Okay, to that extent, we build loyalty with our service providers. That is the point I want to tell you. Okay, to that extent, since there is a cordial relationship with all our stakeholders, who runs the business or who owns it, who runs the business, the conflict is not that most of the time.
Right. No, that's really great. So, I was reading somewhere that I think one of you saying that first 3 years is the most difficult part for a new joinee, but once they've crossed that first 3 year mark, then the loyalty is there forever. So, you know, I guess that's what you're saying, that, you know, very, very loyal staff and plus loyal stakeholders. Right?
See, funny way, put it other way, but it is also real happening.
Right.
See, the fellow joins. See, they're also very hot in the marriage market. See, the fellow joins, Ramco Cement, people would prefer to give. Some of the cases. See, right. Once they get married, there may be pressure from the wife. Okay, why don't you stay in the factory? We have to move to Chennai or some places. See, we don't want to stay in the factory. See, that are the most of the, some magicians in my engineers, all these things. You see, okay, they don't, maybe they'll get, because unlike before, now all of, even the girls are educated. So they want to stay in the factory rather than, so they want to stay in the cities rather than the factory. So that is why what we have done, we have also improved our colony or township by such that, okay, maybe if you ask me 20 years back, we didn't have schools. We didn't have schools in our colonies. So they have to send the children to other places, even 20 kilometers, 30 kilometers away for even English medium school or good schools and all these things. See, we started school, CBC service schools in all our factories. We are giving, in fact, our mass code in our schools are better than even city students. Since their facilities created, okay, that is to that extent. Okay, our township facilities also so good, even they can't get in cities, like, okay, indoor stadiums, okay, whatever, gym. Okay, we are also made to very lively township. Okay, to that extent, so even now we are getting requests also, don't transfer me to corporate office and let's stay in the factory.
Right.
So there will be a lot of difference. That is why, okay, once they stay in 3 years or 4 years, okay, they understand the philosophy of company, okay, they take some ownership, so they try to, that I can give you statistics, what percentage of people are with more than certain years of the company. Almost, if you see, 50-60% of the people are not only this one, they are first employment is only Ramco Cement. The only employment is Ramco Cement. to the text, our people's mind is not polluted by other environments.
Sure, sir. Just a sec. The thing that I wanted to talk about in terms of, you know, in your annual report, you've talked much more about ESG this time. And, you know, ESG is actually one of the more challenging things for cement industry because it's considered quite a polluting industry across the world. What's your view in terms of how things will evolve here? Would it increase costs? Because if you have to adhere to some of the norms, and what are you doing about it as a company?
Yeah. See, maybe ESG is the norm given today, but we have adopted ESG as early in 1980s. We are even today, I can proudly say, we are the only and the first cement company to invest in windmills. And today, even Ramco Cement owns almost 190 megawatt, almost 200 megawatt windmills. With that, today's capacity, I can run half of the my capacity with windmills. Another half of the capacity we invested in waste heat recovery. To the extent 100% of our cement, I can proudly say we are green. And to the power, okay, fuel sites will be used coal, pet coke, and all these things. I can tell you, okay, cement industry has two things. One is power, and another is fuel.
Right.
Our side of that, 100% we have gone for that carbon neutral. Not now, we have gone very, very early. So that is why I can proudly say that we are a very ESG compliant company, and we are very forward in that. Also, we are the one of the earliest to implement electrical ESKs. At the time, people don't know. So, okay, the people judge your efficiency, the way in which the smoke comes out of your chimneys. If dust does not come out of the chimney, then people think your plants are shut down, or there's some problem in the plant. There is the perception of the public, also perception of the people. But in the early 80s itself, or even late 70s, when we gone for our RNA expansion, we have only the few companies go and install electrostatic precipitators, that is ESPs, to capture the dust, to reduce the dust emission. Then, whatever the government and norms for the dust emission, they have certain norms. Okay, when they prescribe 100, normally used to achieve 50. When they based on certain companies, this one like us, they benchmark. Okay, when Ramco Cement is able to achieve 50, okay, that should be industry norms. Okay, when they wanted to fix in the 50s now, we gone to 20. Like that, we have gone on investing a lot of money in protecting the environment. For example, we are the first company to go for back filters. At that time, the difference between investment back filters, the back filters are mainly to capture the dust. It also helps you because otherwise the dust will, even 1 or 2% of cement will be emitted outside. Even we are able to capture that and put it to our process. That extent, there is a cost saving. Also, we are protecting the environment. I have very bad experience or good experience with the government because I didn't see my approval environmental clearance. They told I had to put ESPs. It seems they mentioned it's ESPs. But we, 4 times more than that, we invested back filters. The back filters cost at that time 4 times of the ESPs. We invested back filters. So there is a process in environmental clearance. There is before setting up plant, you have to get clearance. Once you set up the plant also, you have to go and get the clearance from them to run the factory. When they told, okay, have you installed ESPs? So I installed back filters. Immediately they told, no. I given an approval to install ESP. How come we can put up back houses? Then, even though we explained to them how back houses are
more efficient,
more costly, we've gone for it. I'm not pollution about gold. No. Otherwise, you go to central government, amend it. Personally, I went to by myself on technical, we sat in central government. We spent 4 days even to convince at that time in central pollution authorities and get it amended. To that extent, I am advanced. Even the people in even pollution control board, they don't understand what is the difference between ESPs, what is the difference between backhouse, how the backhouse is more efficient than ESPs. But our technical people, they understand the need for the backhouses. Then only that we can we can arrest the dust very well. And even though it is costly, it is 4 times costlier at that time. See, to that extent, we took a lot of care for the environment, I told you. Then, as far as the social concern, that the CSR in our DNA, not today, 1933. See, the central government might just annul the CSR, whatever norms were counted to percent of your net profit you would spend on CSR is ruled today. But in year 66, one of the companies, 5% of the net profit we have to, even the part of the turnover we have to give it to CSR. There is a AGM resolution for that. Okay, to that extent, we are not the cost of the law today by net, by as a good corporate citizen. Okay, normally our this one is say, okay, whatever profit we are in, that is only out of the whatever money taken from the society, we will give back to the society. See, our this one is give back to all the stakeholders whatever possible by you. So to that extent, our CSR activity is not started today. We started even in the early 60s, and we are running a number of, because our promoters, we are coming from a place where education is very backward. So at that time itself, we started a number of schools, polytechnic, ITIs. Now we are running even engineering colleges, 100% on charity. We don't charge anything, even we don't simply pay any donation from them. And like that, almost today, if you see Ramco Group, we'll be running schools where almost 30,000 students will be studying in the factories, in the town where we are in this one. So even Chennai, we are running school. Like that, CSR, lot of initiatives were taken. So corporate governance, as the right way, this one says, as far as the governance is concerned, again, in even take, for example, Ramco Cement, even though the government, even they allowed 50% independent, that Indian family won't, we have only 1% out of 6 or 7. See, like that, to that extent, we adopted the corporate governance at the earliest possible time.
Yeah, apart from that, I think Dharmakrishna has explained more. I think enumerated most of the things. One more thing is also on the environmental protection. Also, we have initiated quite a bit. If you take mines, if you see in cement industry, we do a lot of mining. And after the mining is done, the mines are abandoned. It looks, quite desolate, the places and so on and so forth. So we've started taking initiative and trying to reforest those mines, make them lakes, forest, regenerate it so that, you have all the native plants and trees coming back. As a pilot, we've started in one of our mines, about 80 to 100 acres. Now we're expanding that to over the next 3-4 years to 800 acres. And that initiative, and we are trying to have that as a process to all our mines, whichever abandoned mines, pits and all that, how do you reforest it, attract animals and make it dense forest so that it's a very attractive place and life comes back there. So that also initiative we've taken, and I think that's also probably a first for mining in India.
In fact, I think you put a picture of that in your annual report also, I think. So, sir, moving to slightly different tack in terms of growth, if you see past, you've basically grown without raising, after your first public issue, you've not raised even one rupee. And you've grown consistently using internal generation or debt. So I have a few questions around it. The first is, given that the industry is now much more consolidated, and even if I see your EBITDA per ton is actually now pretty high, do you think it's time to actually grow a bit more aggressively than just through internal generation and debt, or you think that's still the right strategy?
If you're talking about acquisitions, I think
not just that, both acquisitions and even greenfield, would you want bigger or some other places? So yeah, both.
Yeah, basically, if you see greenfield, it's far more difficult nowadays,
right?
Because your auctions of mines and so on and so forth. So that is there. But wherever we have mines and our limestone deposits, basically in the south, We are growing aggressively. Actually, we've just added about 5 to 6 million tons, 5 to 6 million tons of cement now. So from 12 to 15, we are going to about 19, 20 million tons. Yeah. And once that stabilizes, we will continue to, you know, and we stabilize the markets, we'll continue to expand. And that is our model, because it's also very important that whatever we do and expand, it's not about just the capacity. Can we bring in the market network, which is solid? Can we bring in the loyalty of our customers? So we do a lot of field work rather than just push cement. That's also, you can see that we are almost, we are even in the newest markets, we are either in the A category or just one small step behind the A categories. Even in our markets where we are just entering, we work towards that. So we are not going to capture market by discounting prices. So it's a little more ponderous, but I think it's long lasting is what we feel. So that's been our approach.
And what about acquisition, sir?
Acquisition, we have been, you know, bidding in all those sort of things.
Right.
But I don't think at the rates at which these acquisitions have gone, our balance sheet couldn't take it. I mean, the risk was too high.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I add a little bit more. See, yeah. Today in the cement industry, there are two things. See, basically, you should take clinker capacity rather than cement capacity.
Yeah.
You have to, so if at all today, you have to benchmark what is real capacity of companies, you have to look at what is the clinker capacity and what is the cement capacity. Okay, cement capacity, people may say, okay, the conversion ratio, this is high, all these things, but normally what people are telling that, okay, put some 10 grinding units and I'll include their capacity also as my total capacity. That is what people are reporting. So many times people carried away that, okay, that companies are 40 million, certain companies are 40 million company. If really see whether those companies are capable of putting 40 million tons, even though they go for 100% slag cement, 100% blended cement, all these things, but really they can go only 20 to 20 million tons. But if you see the nameplate or what a number plate, if you see that those companies declare I am a 40 million ton company. See, but in Ramco cement, I'm telling you, at any point of time, whatever capacity I'm creating is with my clinker, what cement I can produce. Okay, today when my MD says, okay, ours is a 20 million ton company, with my clinker, we can produce 20 million ton. We can produce cement of 20 million tons also. Normally we lay to that. Okay, some small excess capacity of 3-4 million tons normally we create because of the flexibility in my dispatches. So you ask me, okay, how you have grown the capacity. In 2006, our capacity was 6 million tons. Then in 2011-12, the capacity was 12 million tons. So in the matter of 5 years, we have doubled our capacity. What I'm telling, this is the installed capacity of cement what Capro producing. Then in 2012-13, we gone to 15 million tons. Then today, from there, we are jumping to 20 million tons. See, when we do that, we are also seeing, see, we should also see the capacity utilization. See, I can create capacity, whether I'm able to use the capacity also very important, because otherwise it's also going to cost us money. See, you see the capacity utilization, 2006-07, 96%, 98%, 80%, 82%. See, we don't operate at 40% and telling that, okay, I have capacity so much. See, that is again, see my, suppose I can't put the capacity much ahead of the demand. At the same time, here it was, I can't offer the demand also I can put up, because if people who are having the capacity will take away market share. So normally, fortunately, so far, whatever we have done, we have aligned the market demand, and we never created big surplus in our capacity ahead of the market. And at the same time, we're not that behind as though we lost the opportunity.
Even now we have come in with capacity at almost the right time.
Right.
Got late because of COVID.
See, even if you see the last 3 years, in 2017-18, our capacity was 81%. Then 18-19, 85%. 19-20, even with COVID, and all these things, 90%. Okay, last year around 75%. See, like that, okay, don't think that we are not aggressive enough in expanding our capacity. If we talk about crew capacities, we are also, that is why, okay, another definitely one, if you ask me one constraint of this one is, okay, we don't want to increase the capital. Okay, with the whatever, so what, whatever capital net worth available, plus what is the reasonable leverage? Okay, the leverage normally bothers us a lot. I don't say it is, at the same time, we are not afraid of borrowing, but at the same time, okay, borrowing goes to beyond certain level. Definitely, we are little, very reasonable. We want to be very reasonable in that, so that we're not risking the investors' money or investors' investment also. So, the both we are looking, we should be balancing it.
Right. So, but just one point on leverage, you know, last time, although maybe this is slightly wrong way of looking at it from a commodity perspective, but if you look at last peak, your net debt to EBITDA had gone up by to 4.5 times. This time it will probably peak, it has already peaked at maybe 2.5 times. So, you know, again, you know, this point is, could you be a bit more aggressive was the point from even from a leverage perspective. On leverage, or you think that net debt to EBITDA is the wrong way of even looking at it?
Yeah, you are right. Now it is around 2 times. You are right. This one.
He's saying, can you get more aggressive?
Yeah, yeah. See, that is why we have plans.
Right.
See, we have plans. See, unfortunately, see, we are not able to the way in which we want to go because last 2 years, even though I have, we have selected the best contractors in the country, best contractor who near just this one. We are not able to extract work from them. In fact, we are doing the project by project. See, we never had such bad experience in handling our project as what we had last 2 years because COVID. before this COVID time, normally we used to go with smaller, I don't say large contractors, but reasonably medium size or smaller contractor, we were able to extract good work from them. Unfortunately, during the last, the crisis, the financial crisis, most of the contracts have gone bankrupt. Now, either it goes too small or too big.
Right.
Too big is throw up their hands when the crisis comes. Too small also, they could not help because they have not have the sufficient infrastructure to handle the project. Like, okay, cranes, okay, number of people, all these things. Okay, now the project management is also very, very important. Okay, the future project also, okay, we are handling differently, little differently. We are encouraging some contractors so that they can also become little big. To handle our projects. Okay, this COVID only slowed down our little aggressiveness or thinking to create a little more capacities. Also, to some extent, the COVID also affected some of our initiatives to market it aggressively. See, certain marketing initiative we took so that our brand image, our premiumness in the price. See, all these things will go tremendously like that. We have certain dream ideas and certain dream project, but that definitely requires 100% personal contacts. Okay, at the right time of when we wanted to expand that in a big way. Unfortunately, the pandemic has come. We could not make a personal contact. Definitely, that dampened our spirit. That affected our little. Teams the first to grow also a little more of what we might have done much more growth than what our situation today. Okay, once that there is also question of timing. See, already to do that, already infrastructure is in place. Already we have a very big team for that. We also we took the time of this pandemic, trained them well, and whatever message we have to give it to the customers, all these things, we have took the time and we have done that also. Once, okay, I don't say the normalcy fully come because even today our main market like Kerala is under a pandemic problem. See, once the normalcy comes, definitely we are very confident that our brand image will go much more than what we are today, and the efforts to for 3 members of the cement will also go up than what we are today.
Thank you. So, okay, coming to in terms of financials, so you all put a lot of emphasis on EVA as you've put in your annual reports also. But if I look at your CapEx, generally your CapEx per ton is higher because of a lot of infrastructure you put, or you can buy more land which can go on. Hence, the growth opportunity is much longer. So if I were to put all these things together and maybe add also higher margins, but just because you've kind of you put more capex than opex. So if I put that all together, when you look at a project, when do you want the EVA to turn positive? Like, what is your horizon when you look at things?
See, the best answer is your Amex report. See, many investors, many fund managers raise this question. Every fund manager raises this question. So I ask them, please read Amex report. Even day before yesterday, I told the same thing to DSP people. And also, my investor call also, I told the same thing. So I don't know whether you had an occasion to go through Amex report in full.
So,
I passed my answer. See, the answer is your own internal reports. So you please go through that. Even I can have a call again.
That's a report you've gone through. Your word, whether that report is,
No, the report is out. It's not, don't think the report is under preparation. The report is already circulated, well accepted. Okay, whoever reads the report, they appreciate you are. Whoever does not read the report, they only put the question to me. And we did Sanjeev, we said, no. I requested Amit to visit very important facilities because people like Amit should understand what are the facilities. Because of the facilities, okay, whatever we claim, what are things? Okay, we claim the right cement for right application, the premium of cement, brand bidding. All these things depends upon that. All our efforts depends upon that certain efforts, what we have done last 3-4 years. I'm telling you, nobody in the country has created such facilities. And two ways is going to help. Whatever we do today, our cost will be definitely cheaper. The capex might have been maybe higher, but our operating cost will be definitely cheaper than anybody else. And also the incremental investment is going to be very, very minimum. It is, you may not believe, suppose the two extremes. When I told the initial investment, you will not believe. Okay, when other companies are able to invest only with 300 crores, why the company should 700 crores? Then my incremental cost will come 60 crores. You will not believe how come these people can create 60 crores.
Right.
See, like that, whenever the initial investments are made, we make in such a way, the future investments is and the future whatever implementation time should be short, cheaper, and everything. Because once I do that, the unfortunate cement industry also, we once you don't plan at the beginning, our experience, the modification of all these things. Cost a lot of money, also a lot of inefficiencies are built in.
Okay.
So to take care of all these things, the last 3-4 years when we have not done capacity additions, but we have invested in these things.
Sure.
That is why always our capex makes us high, but that the company will enjoy the benefit next 50 years. Till the existence of the company, the company will derive the benefit because those things are infrastructure. Like, road, okay, what is it? Whether investment road will benefit today, do not benefit today. Okay, whatever Wi-Fi has done, today we'll enjoy that benefit.
Yeah.
See, nobody at that time appreciated why so much investment in the road projects. Okay, is it this one? Okay, today people are talking, okay, Bombay to Delhi, I can reach in 7 hours or 8 hours, which used to be 7 days or 8 days today because of Vishram Wi-Fi. Like that, see, we invest a lot in infrastructure. These things will benefit very, very long. Way because definitely the future, the cost of not only the cost of putting up that capacity, also the cost of operating going to be very costly.
Right. Sure. Thank you, sir. So, question for you, Mr. Raja, and this is a very macro question. And before I hand it to Amit to ask question, till January, February, we used to hear a lot of noise that steel mills have charging such high price, cement companies are charging such high price, how do you do construction? We used to hear from the government and so on. We recently even spoke to, and post the budget, things seem to have changed. We haven't heard much about that. Even budget talked about wealth, making wealth is good, profit is good. We recently had a similar fireside chat with the CEO. He also said, wealth is good, private sector making money is good. Do you think there is a perceptible change in the way government is thinking?
Yes, I think there is, because I think they want to be able to enthuse. I think government has finally realized the public sector alone cannot make Indian economy compete in the world market. It has to empower even the private sector and the medium scale industries, large scale industries, everybody has, and even the small scale industries, how do you enthuse them to start creating capacity and become and create jobs and basically, you know, take some market share from the East Asian countries? I think that seems to be the new policy now. And I think, and they're making the right messaging and, you know, the right incentive schemes and all that are being put. But there also you see some sort of bias in certain sectors. Right? The incentive schemes need not be just, can be tuned a little better to basically address a broader scope. For example, in textile policy, they've come up with basically, you know, for man-made fibers and technical textiles and man-made fiber, technical textiles, and one more.
Winter, autumn.
And one more, man-made fiber, technical textiles, and one more, garments, correct. But the important point they have to understand is, but there's a lot of scope in other areas in textiles also, for production itself, and that can also grow. And there is some perceptible shift by Western markets away from China and so on. So these things, you know, if they're a little more open rather than being too narrow, I think we can do much more.
Great, sir. Thanks. Amit, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. So I'll just ask the question which has come in a Q&A. So, sir, the first question is related to actually demand side. So the question is related to Tamil Nadu and Kerala market. Tamil Nadu and Kerala market last 1 year is more impacted than the other parts during the pandemic. But however, if we look at these markets over the last 10 years or so, this market has not grown. It's more or less flat if you look at the market size in this. So how do we see these markets in a coming year? Is there a potential to grow now, or it is still in a consolidation phase, these markets? So what's your view?
Yes, exactly. That is the reverse. If you see 10 years before that, if you see the decay, then South market had a consistent, or maybe 15 years before that, if you see this one, South market always had consistent growth over 10%. And other markets, they never grown more than 3 to 4%. See, that is why a lot of capacity has come up in South also. See, the unfortunately, the South Indian political system has become a little unstable. Even though there was stable government, but unfortunately, leadership has not given that much vision to the people. That is why industrialization definitely a little lack behind, whatever industrialization took place 15 years back, what is the rapid, for example, take Chennai. To even today, they have leadership in automobile because of the leadership given whatever 15 years back. Okay, it may be Ford, it may be Hyundai. See, then whatever, maybe other three, four brands, whatever, Renault, all these things has come at that time. Lot of stability in the policies also of the government. So a lot of demand was very good. See, again, it is like a European market, something like that. The demand cannot be more than certain percentage because the market is mature. See, unlike Eastern and other markets, the infrastructure, the government of definitely the southern infrastructure was much better than the other parts of Eastern and all these things. It may be rural roads, it may be even housing. See, the people are talking about housing, Mr. Modi is this one, but Tamil Nadu implemented this thing 15 years back by Mr. Karnataka. Okay, if you construct a concrete house, I'll give you 1 lakh or 2 lakh rupees, like that. See, these governments took a lot of initiatives before, but afterwards, since they were also concentrating, also we are the first to give a lot of freebies, like free laptops, free scooter, all these things. Unfortunately, their mind gone to very, very short-term freebies rather than little long-term freebies. So definitely that affected the economy of the southern states. But now, okay, whatever new government in Tamil Nadu, they realize that now they are telling no. Now they have, the freebies are important. At the same time, I have to bother about my fiscal discipline, all these things, and we have to invest in a lot of infrastructure. See, they announced a lot of scheme for infrastructure. This was okay. Definitely today there will be concerned with one because of government has not come. Okay, once maybe another 6 months time, because the government is also new. Once this little bit time they're taking, definitely we are confident Tamil Nadu with the bounce back, because they know very well the present government. Definitely the finance minister, obviously they are well educated, they also understand the need for investments, and only the freebies alone will not develop the state, otherwise it will go backward. See, they also realize a lot of things, and even government of India does not have such advisors. Today the advisors for Tamil Nadu government are all world renowned, and even government of India does not have such advisors. Okay, if they take this advice seriously, I am confident Tamil Nadu will definitely will bounce back in the industries. Kerala, okay, Kerala is very similar, it's for industrialization. At the same time, always the NRI funds comes into Kerala is not parallel next to Punjab, or maybe ahead of Punjab, I don't know. But definitely those, definitely that there's no stoppage of funds coming into Kerala from NRIs. So the only investment that can be in only real estate. So definitely the Kerala market also wants. See, today the problem is again, most of the markets are closed. What's the market? Whenever I'm seeing little normalcy, definitely a lot of housing demand is going up. So I'm confident Kerala and Tamil Nadu, once little normalcy comes, they bounce back.
Yeah, sure, sir. Yeah, so sir, next question is related to similar thing on a demand side. So basically last 3 years, our sales volume is mostly constant, primarily because of the capacity constant as well as the pandemic impact was there. Now we are well placed with the incremental capacity as well as the demand recovery is coming. And as you have said, we have a track record to operate at 80% plus in capacity utilization. So in how many years we can expect to reach to that level of utilization, as this time our capacity increase is significant from 12 to 20 million ton.
So again, I don't want to put in a particular number, say okay within 2 years I raise 3 years rates. Okay, little difficult to tell me today, but definitely our growth rate would be much better than the industry, much better than the southern this one, much better than the industry. Okay, we have our own internal targets definitely. With our what are the initiatives I explained to you earlier with the segmentation of cement specialization, that will also help us to increase our capacity, to reach our capacity is much better.
Okay. In terms of sir, one is the question is related to the cost side. How much of the cost of efficiency like WHRS is already into the system, and how much we are still due to come into the our numbers in terms of the freight synergy as well as the WHRS, and our Kurnool capacity, how much cost efficient it could be as compared to our existing plants?
I think for the existing WHRS, I think 80% has come, right?
Yeah. See, Jayendavaram, see, Tamil Nadu, in Tamil Nadu plants, full WHRS is not possible because moisture in the raw material, so that heat we are using for drying our materials. But whatever possible, okay, different way, either WHRS can be to increase your increase the power output, or you can decrease the power cost also, because by preheating certain modification you can do that. So in Tamil Nadu, one plant is already implemented. We have good saving, and another plant will be commissioned by this December, January. So that is possible. But in Jayendavaram, in line one, line two, 100% WHR is already commissioned. We are getting definitely our efficiency one of best in the industry. And the third line, WHRS, 80% of that will be commissioned another maybe 45 days, maybe 2 months time. And remaining 20% will be commissioned by March. And
the new Kurnool
project, WHRS will be commissioned only 4 or 5 months or 6 months after the commissioning of the kiln. It will not come along with the kiln because of the labor shortage and the contract delay, all these things. First, our preference is to put up the plant rather than other fixed one. So, otherwise, it might have come along with the project. So maybe the project will be commissioned before October. Clinker will come before October, this one. Okay, maybe in another 6 months' time, WHRS will be commissioned. Okay. Since all our plants are its own unique advantage of cost saving, I don't say the carbon cost wise will be significantly reduced. See, there also there are some advantages. At the same time, we have certain disadvantages. So for example, take Tamil Nadu plant. We are only 200 kilometers away from the port, or only 200, 300, 200, 250 kilometers away from the my pet coke source. That advantage I am not going to get in Karnool. The Karnool definitely my limestone cost, all these things will be very cheap. Additive cost will be very cheap. But power and fuel cannot be cheaper than my Tamil Nadu plants. Like that, we have advantage, disadvantage. The cost will be almost same. I don't say any distinct advantage of my cost reduction, but the raw material availability, limestone availability is huge. Okay, any number of expansion we can plan in Karnool rather than in Tamil Nadu.
Okay, sir. Yeah, sir, the next question is related to cost only. So we have seen that the pet coke and coal prices have witnessed sharp increase over the last 1 year. In fact, it is sharper in the last one quarter. What's your view on these cost items? Is it sustainable or sticky, or it is going to taper down in the coming quarters? As well as the industry is still unable to pass on these hikes in the cost. How do we see the pricing trend in coming quarters?
See, when the pet coke prices and coal prices are soft, anybody's guess. See, I'm not a soothsayer to telling that, okay, from next month onwards it will come down, because we don't know. We don't know the real dynamics of, okay, why the pet coke might have gone so much. Really, if you ask me, it surprised me. But same thing I have seen in 2008. In fact, 2008, the prices are much higher than what we are buying today. But the way in which the prices crash from $165 to $40. See, my one pet coke price in 2008, okay, like this, the price was going up. One shipment I purchased at $160. Do not believe it. Next shipment I bought for $100. Then seven shipment I bought for $45. See, all these things depends upon the commodity prices, okay, the way in which the commodity price is going up, God only knows whether it is a real or bubble, when it will burst, nobody can predict. I don't say I have any tool, or with my 40 years of experience, I can't say it will burst tomorrow or day after tomorrow or 1 month or 2 months. Definitely, I have no idea. But the price is still going up. Don't think already we keep the peak. The price is still going up. When I talk to the people, when, for example, shipping freight from Indonesia, this one, what was $7 today? $45. Okay, even if the shipping flows are delayed, okay, sir, whether the $45 are peak or this one, also nobody can say, even if still it can go up. See, these things definitely nobody's control. Yes, definitely we are not able to pass on, because all these, we have enough stock, we have good amount of stock, so we didn't have to feel the pinch of the cost increase. Okay, when we feel the pinch of cost increase, unfortunately, the pandemic is set in and the monsoon was very severe. And we never had such unseasonal rains. In fact, even 3 days back in Odisha, in our site, we had almost 25 centimeters rain in one night, matter of 12 hours. And the driveway,
20
centimeters, 250 mm. See, like that, there is unseasonal rains everywhere. Yeah, including Delhi, including most part of the country. Okay, to that extent, since there is a capacity additions, okay, people think, okay, I got to push cement. What is the point with that? So once the monsoon is over, and again, once the monsoon over, unfortunately, in East will set in for the puja holidays. Okay, maybe in month or two it will be like this. Afterwards, I feel from November the middle, from onwards, once the puja is over, definitely the prices will stabilized and prices will go up. And market also will be a good amount of offtake also from the market.
Okay. Sir, next question is related to CapEx, which you have already explained. Just addition, we have just completed the aggressive CapEx in South. which can cater to the future growth. But we have any plan to put the clinker outside the south market, or we have any limestone mines in other regions?
We don't have. Okay, okay. Some bidding are coming up. You are going to participate in bidding.
Okay.
Like all companies,
so it is bidding is coming. So it is. I don't know whether it succeed. We don't succeed. All these things depends upon some. So some biddings are coming up in different parts of the country. We are participating.
Yeah. In addition to that, in the same question is that, sir, we have any potential for the incremental capacity in Tamil Nadu based on the limestone availability, or incremental limestone is coming for any kind of bidding in that market also?
So Aranagar we are expanding. That is in our public domain. Already we announced the Aranagar expansion. Okay. Again, Tamil Nadu already we purchased a lot of lands. It is having limestone, but we don't have the mining leases. Definitely bidding comes, definitely will be the most preferred this one. See, we have a good amount of resources there. Okay, once the bidding process complete, we may be able to expand in Tamil Nadu also, depending upon that.
One question is related to deleveraging, sir. You have this question also you have addressed, but it is just reverse to what Sanjeev sir has asked. During 10 to 15, when we were in a capex cycle, our debt has elevated to 30 billion. And within two years, we were able to deleverage. We are back to similar level of debt due to capex, but our cash flow profile is much stronger this time. Can we expect deleveraging in the coming years, despite we have some growth capex plan also?
See, these are concrete questions. One side, you want us to expand. Another side, you want to deleverage. So we'll yes, take sir. Very fancy. I don't want to correct my own statement. Okay, one side I told you, okay, once the pandemic is over, I have aggressive plans to expand whatever possible. So another side, if I give commitment on, I have 100% deleverage, both does not go together. Okay, we'll be very, very sensible in our capex. Our capital allocation will be very, very sensible. Definitely, we will not put the company at risk.
Right. Sir, in our annual report, we have mentioned project cost increase. Is it done, or still there is an increase is possible in our cost, project cost?
No, that is why we explained in detail. See, the project cost increase not necessarily an account of delay in the project, not necessarily an account of that. Also, what we have done, see, during the course of the project itself, I told you this concept of right cement for the right application. Okay, this thing comes. So we created a lot more facilities than we anticipated. See, because the project was conceived some 4 years back at that time, these things. Okay, now lot of more. See, for example, if you want to put second line, already foundation has been made so that there's no, then okay, to that extent, our foundation cost, even the time as well as cost will come down. Like that, lot of work has been already done for the expansion at much cheaper cost. That also inbuilt in the escalation for the cost.
So one question, I think last question is related to the East market. So we have witnessed a sharp correction in cement prices over the last 2 months in the Eastern market, which appears to be more than the seasonal weakness. How are we placed in this kind of scenario in terms of the operational cost, how we are in comparison to the peer group? And what's your view on this market?
No, we are as competitive as any player. As any even yet. Whatever air brand players
in the East, you
say in the East, we are as competitive as air brand players. So any market we operate, the cost as well as the realization is important to us. Okay, for somebody else it comes down, it will also comes down to us. Okay, to what extent come down to us and come to others? That is this one. Always our endeavor is okay. How to reduce the cost further? How to reduce the cost further? That is always our endeavor. We are making our efforts. So definitely we are not losing.
Any view on our Eastern market, sir? What do you see?
Yes, bro. These are all unseasonal rains. See, we never had such rains. Both the interior, both Orissa and Bengal. And this one, even the month of September, they have record. Month of August also, September, they have record rains. They never had such rains. See, again, see, pandemic, followed by rain. So these are just it is extending. See, there's no this one. Okay, even this small time gap, you might have seen big spurting in demand because that is the nature is not allowing that. So, by eastern market, there's a great potential, definitely grow.
Yeah, that's it, sir. I will hand over to Sanjeev, sir. For
so, I've got one question that someone has sent, which is that is it possible to monetize the windmill part of the business, and what else, you know, in terms of other businesses, what is the commitment of capital?
One side, I am in ESG compliance, so we can proudly say we are the largest owners of windmill. So this, what we suppose tomorrow coal prices, just I'm telling you, tomorrow coal price goes to $200, we have $200. Will be the least cost producer because my 100% of even 5 to 6 million tons I can produce at zero cost, that zero cost of power.
Sure.
Except okay, except wheeling charges and whatever government statutory charges only I got to pay. Fortunately, God does not charge for the nobody charge for the wind. See, like that, see, there are sometimes the opportunity comes. We don't know. Suppose if you monetize that, to create such capacity is impossible again.
Right.
Because you do not believe we have so much land bank. And to buy the land, put up the windmills, it is impossible. Now, most of the windmill manufacturers, they vanished. Windmills are there, but windmill manufacturers, most of them become sick.
Yeah.
So that it is impossible to create such assets again. So the monetization is very easy. See, definitely with all the big players in India, they want to go green, they're ready to invest any money. So the monetization is the simplest thing we can do, or easiest thing we can do. But whether we can create this asset again, it is impossible. So we have to think not even 100 times, we have to think 1,000 times before we would like to even monetize even part of it.
Sure. Sir, also on capital commitment to any other businesses?
From long-term cement, no.
As of now.
Okay. Okay, sir, that's, I guess, those are any questions. Anything that you want to mention, any, you know, Mr. Raja, Mr. Dharmakrishna, anything that you all want us to take away from here?
No, I think your question have been very incisive. I think you've been able to glean whatever I think we had to say.
Right.
I think it was a very nice conversation.
So, thank you. So thank you
request,
for that.
My request to BND Secretary is okay. So the, you should more carry on what are the good works we are doing that. You should also speak, not only me, if people like BNK Securities talk very loud. So definitely whatever good work done by us will be appreciated. And the market can also, okay, what I'm telling, the ESG, whatever we invest in windmill, nobody knows. We think people, that is what people are thinking, why don't you monetize that?
Sure.
See, you should also tell, okay, Ramco Cement has done so much investment, not today, even when people don't know anything about an ESG. See, such things you should talk in various of your forums, whenever you meet these customers, your own fund clients like fund managers, all these things. You should, if you are highlight more, so definitely whatever good work done by us would be appreciated.
I think in terms of environmental and the ESG part, I think we may be among the top 2-3 companies in the country.
Right.
For our size.
And absolutely. And yeah, absolutely, sir. And thank you so much, Mr. Raja, Mr. Dharmakrishna, for your time. And, you know, we'll, as usual, we'll be in touch and keep learning new things.
Thank you.
Thank you. And all the
thank best. Thank you, BNK team, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.